Penguin Random House Audio presents Robert Ludlum's The Treadstone Resurrection by Joshua Hood. Read for you by Ron Butler. Prologue. Buena Vista, Venezuela. Nick Ford sat in the back of the filthy pickup, his body racked with fever, pain radiating from the bullet hole in his leg. He was exhausted, and his body screamed for sleep. But every time he closed his eyes, he found himself back in the jungle. Caught in the kill zone. Machine guns chattering from the shadows. The caustic fog of fresh gunpowder, and the screams of his dying teammates. Dead. All of them. Ford still couldn't wrap his mind around what had happened. How he'd managed to lose an entire team on what was supposed to be an easy recon. There was only one answer that made any sense. We were betrayed. The truck rattled to a halt, and Ford pulled himself to his feet and climbed down to the muddy street. He limped to the driver's side window, tugged a sweaty wad of bills from his pocket, and passed them to the man behind the wheel.
No, no, senor, the man protested. I can't take that. Not after.
Ford was quick to cut him off.
Jose, you take this, he said,
shoving the cash into the man's calloused hand.
You take this and get your family the hell out of here.
Gracias, Senor Ford. I wish.
Jose, you need to go before it's too late.
Vaya con Dios.
He nodded before shoving the truck into gear and pulling away in a cloud of exhaust. Ford stood on the street and considered his options. He knew Sabine, the dreaded Bolivarian National Intelligence Service, was looking for him, and he knew what they would do when they found him. There was a part of Ford that wished they'd hurry up and find him, put a bullet in his head and get it over with.
There will be time for that later, he told himself. Right now, you have a job to do.
Ford hobbled across the street. The pain was unbearable, each step more painful than the last, but he forced himself to keep moving.
March or die, he ordered himself. Just put one foot in front of the other.
By the time he made it to the alley that smelled of piss and rotted garbage, his shirt was soaked with sweat. He fell against the stone wall, dug the bottle of Percocet from the pocket of the jeans Jose had gotten for him, and thumbed the cap free. The bottle had been full on Monday. Now there were only two pills remaining, enough to get him through the night. After that, Ford knew it wouldn't matter. This had always been a one-way trip. He shook the perks into his mouth and dry swallowed. The pills left a bitter taste in the back of his throat, and then he was moving again. Down the alley, heading north, toward the faded white sign perched atop the Hotel Bolivar. The Bolivar was an ugly pillbox of a building, with pallid stucco walls and sagging razor wire. It was not the kind of hotel you found on TripAdvisor, but Ford trusted the owner, which made it the safest place in the city. By the time he staggered into the dingy lobby, the pills had kicked in and muted the pain in his leg to a dull roar.
Senor Ford, Miguel greeted him in broken English.
The smile on his face crumbled when he saw Ford's condition, and he came around the desk.
You look like the shit. Should I call for the doctor?
No, Ford winced. Just a room and a bottle.
He leaned against the counter and dug the last of his cash from his pocket, slapping it on the scarred surface. The effort left him out of breath.
Of course. Miguel nodded.
He retrieved a bottle of Santa Teresa rum from the shelf and a key from the wallboard and placed them both on the counter.
Thank you, my friend, Ford said.
He took the stairs to the second floor, unlocked the door, and stepped inside. The room reminded him of the shitty double-wide where he'd grown up. Same cigarette-scarred table, yellowed blinds, and musty beer cooler smell. Ford closed the door behind him and set his assault pack on a chair. He cracked the rum and took a deep pull from the bottle,
The liquor burned the back of his throat and settled hot into his gut. Properly fortified for the job ahead, he unzipped the pack and spread its contents on the table. A laptop, 2 shim cameras, a dirt-encrusted camera, and an M18 Claymore mine. The rumble in his stomach reminded him that he hadn't eaten in 9 hours, and he retrieved a can of pineapple that he'd picked up in a market outside of El Nula. He popped the ring and carefully peeled the lid free. 3 years ago, when he first came to Venezuela, the fruit would have cost him $4. But with the economy in freefall and the country gripped in hyperinflation, it cost 3 times that amount in Caracas.
Money. That's what all of this was about, he thought,
spearing the fruit with his knife and placing it in his mouth before picking up the shim cams and stepping out into the hall. The shim cams were a holdover from his time in Special Forces. Each camera was the size of a tube of chapstick, with a lens on one end and a flat tail on the other. They were old tech, massive compared to the micro-surveillance cameras on the market today. But Ford trusted them. And like the name implied, they could be emplaced anywhere. He wedged the first camera into a crack at the end of the hall and angled the lens so it covered the stairwell leading up from the lobby. He used a strip of tape to stick the second camera to the top of the flickering Coke machine and pointed the lens at his door. Back inside the room, he tried to pull the bed against the door, but when he tugged on the box spring, the bed refused to move. He pulled harder, and when it still didn't budge, Ford dropped to his knees. When did Miguel start bolting the beds to the floor? Ford knew it didn't matter and got to his feet. He retrieved a plastic wedge from his assault pack, remembering the words of the man who trained him. Ford, always remember, 1 is none, and 2 is 1. Hayes, still saving my sorry ass, he thought, kicking the wedge under the frame and returning to the assault pack for a roll of 100-mile-an-hour tape, the military's version of duct tape, and the Claymore. He used the tape to secure the Claymore mine to the headrest of the chair. And once he was sure that it would hold, he dragged the chair across the room and checked the angle. When he was sure that it was out of the door's path, Ford screwed the blasting cap into the mine, plugged the free end of the firing wire into the detonator, and carried it into the bathroom. Ford set the detonator on the toilet and turned on the faucet. He splashed water over his face, his mind turning to the cafe outside of Bogota and the last time he saw Hayes.
Nick, I'm leaving.
Leaving? Ford laughed. Where the hell are you going?
No, I'm leaving Treadstone. I'm done.
Done?
Ford frowned.
What do you mean, done?
I'm out. Finished.
Can you do that? I mean,
are they going to let you?
The change in the man's expression was instantaneous. His face went flat, eyes hard and pregnant with the threat of violence. It was a look Ford had seen many times before, one that usually ended with someone bleeding out on the floor. And despite himself, Ford took an involuntary step back. The two men had first met in Special Forces and had forged a tight bond during multiple deployments. They were on the same team in Afghanistan when the CIA plucked them from their firebase and sent them to Treadstone. But it was the fact that they remained close, after the government-sanctioned mine job that was supposed to have ripped them down to the studs, robbed them of the ability to maintain any relationships outside of the missions assigned to them, that surprised the docs at Treadstone. The whole point of the program was to create unstoppable, independent operatives.
No one is letting me do shit,
Hayes snapped, his legendary temper on full display.
Easy, brother. I didn't mean any harm,
Ford said, holding up his hands. Hayes's face softened and a hint of a smile appeared at the corner of his lips.
This isn't about you, bro. This is for me.
Something had happened to Hayes on his last mission, and while Ford didn't know the details, he knew that it had changed him.
But I think you should do the same.
Man, I don't know how to do anything else,
Ford said.
If you ever need anything, all you have to do is ask, Hayes said. And then he was gone.
Ford turned the water off and reached for a towel.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.